Hello, dear colleagues and dear friends. For those of you who don't know me, let me introduce myself. I'm Jana Rošker from Ljubljana University in Slovenia, and I'm professor of sinology, specialized in Chinese philosophy. And I will deliver today a short speech on transcultural problems of transcultural philosophical methodology. And let me first share the PowerPoint. So this speech was intended to be delivered at the workshop on the same topic on transcultural philosophical methodology. At the in Berlin, at the Free University of Berlin, and was organized by Professor Hans Feger, Professor Fabian Heubel, and myself. But due to the pandemic situation, it was then eventually moved online. But this meeting was primarily organized as a discussion platform, actually, for a special issue of the journal Asian Studies, which I'm editing. And this special issue would be on post-comparative, intercultural, and transcultural philosophies. And this issue will be published in September 2022. So, and Fabian Heubel has tried to, the original idea of this meeting in Berlin was that we discuss some of the preliminary contributions to this special issue, because it has attracted many potential authors, and also because its the theme of the special issue is extremely topical. So, but I would like now to begin this talk with the announcement that the special issue, the publication of this special issue is of course still on, and all of you are cordially invited to submit a paper on this topic to the journal, to the journal's website until March 15, 2022 at the latest. On the other hand, Professor Feger from the FU Berlin is also planning to publish an edited volume on related topics in his book series Yearbook for Eastern and Western Philosophy that comes out at the Gruyter publishing house. So we will discuss the structure and the possible contents of this book on our book launch meeting, which will probably take place on site, hopefully, at the FU Berlin by the end of February. So I will begin with an attempt to clarify the nature of possible Western approaches to reading Chinese and East Asian philosophy. When Western scholars and researchers engage with Chinese philosophy, we are always confronted, of course, with different epistemologies, perspective, perceptions, and patterns of knowledge acquisition and transmission. To some extent, and especially when it comes to the ancient and pre-modern, or the so-called classical philosophies, this problem also affects contemporary Asian readers living in a globalized world where the standards of conception and understanding have been assumed from Western cultures or inherited from Western cultures. But before making the main points about these contents, therefore, I will try to clarify the use of some crucial terms that appear in this context and with which we will be constantly confronted in the debates that will follow on the online workshop and then hopefully on many other workshops or debates on these topics that will follow on site. So this Berlin workshop was actually not the first one of this kind. Already in July 2021, we have had an EACP, European Association of Chinese Philosophy, meeting entitled Comparative, Post-Comparative and Transcultural Chinese Philosophy and New Methodologies. It attracted a considerable interest from Western, especially European scholars, but also from Chinese, from some Chinese theorists. This interest undoubtedly underlines the importance and the topicality of this topic. So I think the reasons for this topicality and the timeliness of the debate, of these debates, are obvious. Therefore, that EACP debate, we can see, you can see how all we looked like at this debate, although it was performed online. But the debate was lively and very vivid and energetic, and it brought about many preliminary results in form of new thoughts, inspirations, approaches, and even preliminary methods. So in contrast to the EACP debate, this second debate includes several Western-trained philosophers, and therefore I would first like to address some more general and at the same time more fundamental issues that underline theoretical engagements with transcultural philosophical studies. I will begin with a suggested definition or understanding of some crucial terms. And the first, firstly, I would like in this context to explain how I understand the notions of interculturality and transculturality, respectively. It could be said that our approach to Chinese and Asian philosophy is intercultural in the sense of interaction and engagement of multiple cultures. Interculturality is a specific type of interaction or communication between cultures between discourses in which differences in cultures play a role in the establishment of meaning. So intercultural interactions involve the process of transferring meanings between cultures. However, many contemporary scholars criticize the concept for assuming a notion of culture as islands or spheres and creating a separatist character of cultures. The so-called transcultural understanding of cultures, on the other hand, should offer us a multi-perspective and an inclusive rather than isolated approach. Transcultural philosophy is, of course, already a long-standing discourse, but with ever-changing and evolving paradigms. It has been an important field of philosophical inquiry for at least half a century, beginning with Eduardo Valera's construction of his methodological foundations and developing more or less continuously over the following decades. So I will use both terms, intercultural as well as transcultural, but in different connotations and usages. In my usage, the former, namely intercultural, refers merely to interactions between cultures while the latter, namely transcultural, pertains to the methodological foundations as well as concrete methods of such interactions. While for me, intercultural is a term denoting actions that are carried out in between two or more cultures, it refers to the in-betweenness or the concept of intermediate, of that what is intermediate. The connotations of the term transcultural, on the other hand, are for me, in my view, more basic and refer at the same time to the very process of such interactions and its underlying paradigms. The prefix trans in the term transcultural suggests not only the transgression of one's own boundaries and one's own limitations, while simultaneously, of course, leading to an enrichment and actualization of ourselves. But it cannot be limited to, the term transcultural cannot be limited to this connotation, because it also suggests the possibility of going beyond the actual fragmentation and separateness of different cultures and philosophy. So transcultural approaches therefore aim at overcoming the outdated, static, and immobile concept of culture. However, this does not mean that culture does not exist. It is still a real thing, like language, for example. So both of them, culture and language, these are both some kind of entities that are dynamic, that are historically evolved, and that are ever-changing, and that don't possess any kind of fixed boundaries. So they are not a very fixed category. The ontological assumption underlying the concept of culture therefore does not necessarily refer to a metaphysics of an abstract or substantial being. The same applies for the highly controversial notion of cultural identity. So in the contemporary academia, the notion has often been seen as problematic, and it is problematic because it was also assumed by many very conservative or even reactionary neo-Nazistic movements and so on. But in the academia, it was criticized on the theoretical level also because of the inadequacy of the dialectics of difference and identity. Many scholars see the insistence on cultural differences as the flip side of an undifferentiated thinking that seeks to define the notion of identity as an immutable entity. Well, however, such a view, which implies that there is no such thing as cultural identity, can be critically questioned. Why? Because it can be questioned from the dynamic and processual perspective, which is typical for traditional Chinese philosophical discourses. So in such a context, it can easily be shown that it is wrong to assume that cultural identities are absolutely immutable. Same as the notion of culture. As such, the concept of cultural identities or identity cannot be understood as something substantial that is defined by essence. Indeed, one's cultural identities are seen as dynamically changeable. The alleged problem of the difficult dialectics of identity and difference disappears. Because the two positions are no longer conceived as being two opposing, mutually opposing poles in a mutual contradiction. So in this context, I would like to quote Fabian Heuber's statement. He pointed out in his recent book, What is Chinese Philosophy? Was ist chinesische Philosophie? Which came out in 21 this year, that culture can only change if and because it has identity. And such an identity, of course, is being continuously produced anew in such a viewpoint. Cultural identity is not a phantasm. Rather, identities are actual certainties. The rejection of such actualities or certainties is not only naive and unrealistic, but can lead to a dangerous denial of reality. So the fact that people insist on their cultural identities as soon as they see them being endangered does not disappear by exposing them as constructed and replicable. On the contrary, so when people see what they understand as their identity to be threatened, they tend desperately and blindly to cling even more to that very identity or what they understand under identity. And this can then really lead to destructive nationalisms and racisms and xenophobic attitudes and corresponding political movements. So besides, we cannot but consider the fact that this controversial term is also based upon knowledge, ideas, and structures of meaning mediation that is rooted in long-lasting and very specific historical developments, which cannot be denied. Their differences cannot be denied either. Therefore, it seems equally flawed to either glorify or deny the importance of cultural identity. Instead, we should try to open up a new dimension of transcultural exchange that will challenge the Eurocentric indifference, which blocks not only philosophical engagement with China in Europe, but also the unfolding of the self-critical potential of European philosophy and its power for self-reflection and self-transformation. So, but the now go, I would like to proceed to the second term, which I would like to tackle in this short introduction. And this second term refers, the second question or problem refers to the question of transcultural comparison. So we have already clarified what the term transcultural philosophy mean, and now we will try to explain some problems connected to the very concept of comparisons, if especially philosophical comparisons, and especially if philosophies that were developed in different cultural surroundings are involved in this comparison. So recent controversies in the academic circles have clearly shown that in transcultural context, the notion of comparison as such is a rather problematic one. Moreover, they have revealed that the process of comparing different philosophies as such necessarily involves numerous methodological problems that have not yet been comprehensively reflected upon and are therefore far from being solved. These problems are certainly even more complex when it comes to comparisons between philosophies that have emerged within the framework of different cultural traditions and historical developments. So they are by no means limited to the fact that we have, in such cases, a unifying methodology built on culturally discrete materials. This is only a general aspect of this problem. But the core problem is that the methodology in question is a system that underlies one of the philosophies being compared, namely the Western one, mostly. So there is no third objective methodology. And the same goes for the alleged existence of one standard philosophical language. In this way, we simply identify Western philosophy as the only genuine philosophy and equate Western philosophy with philosophy as such. So if there is only one genuine philosophy, one standard, then the European as well as all other philosophies must be part of the same general and universal discourse, of the same Weltall, we could say, the same world whole. Kant already wrote in his Critique of Pure Reason, if the world whole includes in itself everything existing, then it is neither like nor unlike any other thing, because there is no other thing outside it with which it might be compared. But in fact, Chinese philosophy differs in many crucial aspects or crucial specific features and paradigms from the philosophies that have been developed in the framework of the European intellectual tradition. Considering all this, transcultural philosophical comparisons should be regarded as either very problematic or simply obsolete. So the structure, the development of ideational foundation that enable transcultural understanding is, as I already mentioned, important for Europe in various dimensions of intercultural exchange, both internally and externally. So the problems I was pointing out just now are of course always linked to the structure of power, in which the Western axiology globally assumes a normative role and these problems still exist in spite of the fact that Eastern Asian including China, that Eastern Asia, including China, are increasingly redrawing the map of the world geopolitical, technological, and economic progress. And in spite of the fact that the balance of economic, if not political power, is shifting from the Euro-American to the East Asian region. The fact that Western sinology, the Western, axiology and the thought patterns that have evolved in the process of the historical development, which have shaped what we are accustomed to think about as the European tradition or European culture, is doubtless linked to the relics of colonial ideational legacy that is still influencing the contemporary world. While it is difficult to predict how the global relations of power will evolve in the next years and decades, it is sure that in view of the current crisis we are facing here and now, such as, for instance, global warming or the coronavirus virus pandemic, such crises are global by their very nature, which of course means that they cannot be solved within the narrow borders of individual nation states, but can of course only be tackled globally. So therefore, the idea of an intercultural dialogue and transcultural exchange is more important than ever, especially for Europe, which in itself consists of many different cultural, historical, religious, and linguistic areas. And therefore, I said that these questions are not only important for the so-called East-West cultural and ideational exchange, but for Europe itself, both internally and externally. So especially in this urgently problematic framework, intercultural dialogues that could lead to a global exchange of knowledge, experiences, and ideas assume a more important role than ever before. And by the notion intercultural dialogues, I do not mean the fashionable slogan that has been repeatedly and unceasingly coming out of the mouths of the EU bureaucrats who still understood it as a Western guided conversation between different regions of our world. In this context, we need to consider questions related to the way in which European modernization was important to all non-European regions a couple of centuries ago. So in China, particularly or specifically, this had led to what Fabian Heubel calls hybrid modernization. From this perspective, the coexistence of different systems is first and foremost an internal Chinese model of development that has emerged from the dynamics of hybrid modernization, in which different and mutually exclusive paths of modernization have not only competed with each other since the 19th century, but have repeatedly tried to annihilate each other. So ever since the European states began to forcibly colonize China in the 19th century, China and Europe have entered into a very one-sided intellectual dialogue, namely a dialogue in which Europe speaks and China listens, and then China speaks and Europe turns away. It does not listen. So therefore, the intercultural dialogue between China and Europe has still been marked by a huge asymmetry between the Chinese knowledge of Western philosophy and vice versa. Most of the relevant Western works are translated into Chinese very soon after they are being published in their original languages. But in Western cultural areas, the situation is completely different. Therefore, the superficial understanding, or bolder, the widespread misunderstanding of ancient Chinese texts continues to hold sway in Western theories on China. Among others, one reason for such a situation has to do with the history of Sinology of such, of course. The earliest translation of Confucianism and Taoist texts and also of Buddhist ones were the product of Western missionaries who often interpreted them through the lens of Western concept and methodologies, because they were, of course, pioneers and were not aware of this transcultural, of the many transcultural problems we are dealing with today. But another reason for these prejudices might be found in the fact that there are still almost no translations of later of mature philosophical sources of China in Western languages. While many classical works from the pre-Qin era, from the ancient era, from the ancient period, have been repeatedly translated again and again in all the facets. The West still does not know much about philosophies, Chinese philosophies from later periods, in which Chinese philosophers began to create systematic theories. With some rare exceptions, the main works of Han and Weijin theoreticians, the first centuries after Christ are practically unknown in the Western academia. The early and the mature medieval philosophy is completely unknown. The Neo-Confucian discourses from the Sung and Ming dynasty, the Chinese medieval philosophy, are practically unknown in the Western academia. And the same applies, of course, for almost the entire opus of the pre-modern Chinese philosophy, which is very important for understanding today's China. And the situation is not much better regarding contemporary Chinese philosophy either, although in contemporary times, many Chinese philosophers are already able to write their works in English directly, but not many of them, actually. There is still a huge necessity for translations also of contemporary Chinese philosophical works. So considering all this, it is easier to understand why Western scholars have often criticized Chinese as lacking any systematic theory. But an exchange of knowledge and ideas between China and Europe, which is, as already mentioned, urgently necessary in view of the current political, ecological, and economic crisis. Such an exchange can only be achieved if Europe starts to listen to the voices of Chinese philosophy, if it at least allows for the possibility that these ideas are grounded in a profound and systematic philosophy, even if this philosophy is based upon completely different methodology. And I think that this workshop, which starts today, is a very good step on the way which leads to this, into this direction, namely into the direction of establishing fruitful dialogues, not only between Chinese philosophy and European philosophy, but also between sinologists or experts in Chinese philosophies and experts in Western philosophies. So in this context, it should be emphasized that most scholars of Chinese and East Asian philosophy assume that the concrete ways and linguistic conceptual patterns or structures of perceiving, understanding, and communicating reality are to some extent culturally conditioned. On the other hand, these basic principles are important not only for our knowledge of the forms and mechanisms of human understanding, but also for our choice of actions and attitudes. Therefore, it is high time to thoroughly explore and investigate the underlying paradigms in order to highlight the specificities of the way reality is experienced and theorized in the Chinese or Eastern Asian cultural and linguistic space, with the aim of enhancing the possibilities for a more fruitful and, above all, more authentic intercultural dialogue and knowledge exchange. While the above discussed problem of global power relations belong to the external political and economic reasons for the miserable situation in the current philosophical exchange, this latter question pertains to the internal constitution of the prevailing ideational discourses and their conceptual structures. In other words, these internal reasons are not only limited or directly connected to the existing political and economic power relations, but they also arise due to our unawareness of the existence of different referential frameworks into which culturally and linguistically diverse discourses are necessarily embedded. This notion of a referential framework is something that is very close to the notion of paradigm in the sense of Thomas Kuhn, but also to the notion of different cosmologies, as have been promoted by A.C. Graham and his disciples, for instance, Roger T. Ames. So different cultures, although these referential frameworks or paradigms or these networks of semantic, of different structures of semantic connotations can also be found within the same culture. Let's think about, for instance, the Newtonian physics and the Einstein's physics of the theory of relativity, although they are both written in English, but the terms, and they work with the same notions, but the terms they apply are the same, but they mean something different because they are embedded in different paradigms, in different referential frameworks. So, but this, this problem can become even more severe if we are talking about referential frameworks in which philosophies that were developed in different historical developments, namely philosophies of different cultures, so-called cultures, because different cultures produce necessarily different theories that are embedded into different referential frameworks. These are, on the other hand, linked to different methodologies applied in the process of perceiving, understanding, and interpreting reality. A referential framework, in this sense, can be defined as a relational, semantic, and axiological network of concepts, categories, of terms and ideas which are applied in the cognitive processing of the objects of comprehension. In other words, it defines not only the meaning of all objects within the network, but also the relationships between two or more of these objects. It includes paradigms and perspectives that influence and define the comprehension and evaluation of particular semantic elements within this structure, as well as the structure as the whole. So it is a comprehensive tool used to filter perceptions and to create meanings. So in every transcultural philosophical debate, it is therefore important to consider the different referential frames can lead to different descriptions and interpretations of the same objective reality. This is also the reason why unreflected cross-cultural research often creates misunderstandings between different cultures instead of eliminating or at least reducing them. So the greater the structural, semantic, and axiological distance between two languages, histories, and cultures, the more likely such misunderstandings are to occur. So such structural networks not only define individual concepts and categories applied in a philosophical discourse, but also the very paradigms of thinking and understanding reality that are shaped differently in different historical developments, determined by different linguistic structures and epistemological methods. Without this basic awareness, it will always remain difficult for European academia and to a certain extent even for the Western-trained Chinese scholars to grasp the processual nature of Chinese philosophy, to understand the difference between the mutually contradictive oppositions defining the Cartesian dualisms on the one side and the mutually complementary oppositions or the mutually complementary interactions by which the specifically Chinese binary categories such as yin yang, ban mo, ti yung, and so on, are embedded. It will remain difficult to allow for the existence of notions such as immanent transcendence or transcendence in immanence, or the existence of a one worldview that lies beyond a primitive holism in which everything would supposedly be connected to everything else, and in which and which could not allow for any kind of subject-object relation. Indeed, today, on the threshold of the third millennium, we must finally understand that the alleged absence of subjectivity and also the lack of the tension between the human self and external reality, with which the Chinese philosophy has been repeatedly reproached in the history of Western philosophy, is mainly a product of traditional Western misinterpretations of classical Chinese philosophy. Only on the basis of new and more informed reinterpretations of these discourses can we break new ground in comparative philosophy. And I believe that the time is now more ripe for such endeavors than it was ever before. So indeed, I still believe that comparisons between different culturally and linguistic conditioned philosophies are a very useful tool for gaining new insight into numerous fundamental philosophical questions. However, the previously mentioned problems associated with traditional comparative approaches, which are unreflected or not reflected enough in the light of all these transcultural problems, that they need to be discussed and possibly eliminated. New forms of comparison that might emerge from this constructive debate, such as this debate, for instance, and investigations, will lead to innovative methods of intercultural comparison based on transcultural approaches. So in this somehow more reflective and conscious way, the theme of the so-called intercultural dialogues slowly but surely becomes more than just a fashionable slogan of the EU bureaucrats. Slowly but persistently, it moved from the forefront of Europe's genuine efforts and even necessities. Recently, many different methods and approaches for future intercultural exchange have already been developed and proposed by various experts in Chinese and comparative philosophy. There are Gumingdong's hermeneutics of openness, Chen Zhongying's method of ontohermeneutics, Li Zihao's relationism, Bai Tongdong's contrastive analysis, and Wang Baofeng's paradigm of selection and narratives, to name just a few. So in this workshop, some of the participants also wanted to present and discuss their own views on developing new approaches. In this context, we could mention Ralph Weber's post-comparative philosophy, his notion of tertium, his philosophy of fusion, then Fabian Heubel's energetic transformative subjectivity, or the philosophy of in-between, then the Seleucia Ambrogio's transcultural philosophy of dwelling, then Marion Egert's cultural code switching, and my own transcultural philosophy of sublation or the fusion of aesthetic realms as an hermeneutic method, and so on. So, but different methods lend themselves to different approaches and can be used in different ways by different people, depending on how they conduct research and how they seek answers to the many questions that concern transcultural philosophy. We must therefore not adhere too rigidly to a fixed method, as Margus Ott points out, whom we can see on this in this picture, on this slide, because methods, as he points out, can develop freely and spontaneously in the process of reading, writing, and exchanges with other people. Nevertheless, it is important to be aware of the issues that can arise from a lack of reflection of the on the multiple problems described, which I have described in the first part of this talk. But speaking of talking, the real meaning, I think, of all our efforts is hidden somewhere behind or beneath these lofty phrases. It is important for all of us to find a way to truly communicate with each other and to learn to listen to each other. And the crucial prerequisite for that, of course, is that we learn to shut up, simply to shut up, and to just put up with our own silence. We must stop uttering the empty words with which we hope to drown out and mute anything that threatens to change our preconceived view of the world and also of ourselves. We must try to reinvent a new image or new images of ourselves. So I will stop uttering the empty words right now, and I thank you very much for listening to them so patiently. And I would like to thank once again our two German colleagues, Professor Feger and Professor Heubel, for making this discussion possible, and also all the other participants of this discussion for contributing to it. Thank you very much once again.